Good to see everybody. How are you? It's time for the Ringo red carpet, and none of us got the memo to dress, but that's quite all right.
I'm dressed.
I almost dressed up. I was like, I'll be the schlub. That'll be my plan. No.
I put on jeans.
Actually, Kristen, you got a little accessories going, so I'll count that as dressing. That's fine.
Yeah.
So, who's still open, kids?
We've got the laptop on.
No worries. Oh, good to see everybody. How are you? It's time for the Ringo red carpet.
No, I didn't mean.
None of us got the memo to dress.
Someone's got the YouTube channel open, sounds like.
Yeah.
Well,
there we go. Oh, nope.
That'll be my plan.
Don't worry.
There we go.
All right, we're back.
Yeah.
And we're back.
Down there.
Don't worry, we got 2 more hours of this. It'll be fine.
There we go.
Oh, man, this is as good as it gets.
It's good to see everybody. And Jack Hutchins here, and Sal Crivelli, and Christy Blanche, and Chuck Lindsay. I have no idea who's echoing now.
Christy, I think it might be your headphones.
Oh, okay. Christy, are you on your speaker and thing? We need you to have earbuds on, buddy. Okay, she's got her mute on, so that's cool. Okay.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Thanks, Christy. No problem. Well, this is going to be a very exciting night because there's certainly a lot of nominees and a nice horse race there.
Yeah.
But we also are going to be paying tribute to Mike Ringo as well. We've got some amazing testimonials of people that he helped over the years. And you know, Sal, I am one of those people.
No kidding.
And that's why when we got the opportunity, Chuck and Sal, to do this, I was really pleased because back in 2005, I started Word Balloon, and among my first guests were Jeff Parker.
Ah.
And after posting, and back then it was literally just posting an MP3 on my website, wordballoon.com. iTunes didn't the podcast phase of iTunes, at least,
nope.
Did not exist back then. And 2 days after I posted my interview with Jeff, he had just started working at Marvel at the time, and May of 2005. And want to put it in full context. And I get this email from Mike, and he's like, "Hey, you just interviewed my buddy Jeff, and I'm having trouble, you know, downloading it. Can you help me out? I'm on a Mac." And so I'm like, "Sure, man." You know, told him what I knew. He was able to download it. I'm like, "You wouldn't want to be on the show, would you?"
Right? You're already talking to him. Come on.
And he came on within a month. And also, there were very few. I always use the George Burns joke. We were all in the top 10. There were only 8 of us.
That's right.
Very, very few podcasters out there. So I asked Mike. I said, "Hey, can you be a sounding board?" Because he had done a few podcasts here and there already.
Cool.
And I'm like, I just don't want to be that guy in terms of doing interviews wrong, approaching people wrong, whatever.
Totally.
And for the next 4 years, he was a great sounding board and constant communication, was a cheerleader for me, helped solidify my reputation with other creators, talked to John, he knows what he's doing. And yeah, I mean, what else can I say? Mike was, he was a sweetheart and a very important part of the early stages of Word Balloon. And we lost him too soon. We all know that. That's one of the reasons why they established the Ringo Awards.
Agreed. Yeah. I think one of my first introductions to Mike Ringo's work was thanks to the Baltimore Comic-Con. I know that he was a big purveyor of the show, and I remember going to his booth a couple of times. You know, it was. I never had any direct interaction with Mike Ringo, unfortunately. I wish I did. I feel like I'm the only one who's like, I don't really know him or never knew him. But I loved his work, and because I was a purveyor of podcasts back in the day, I heard his appearances on shows, and everyone I knew who I'd followed loved and respected the hell out of the guy, and said, like, I've only heard lovely, generous, wonderful stories about the man, and you know, it's nice to know because he was also one hell of an artist, and drew some of my favorite stuff when he debuted with Friendly Neighborhood Spider-Man with Peter David. I was like, finally, yes, Ringo's got a shot, because like I've been waiting for something like that. Like with his own title, it was unfortunately saddled with this, the event, the other, and I was like, "Oh man," because he's so like he infused such brightness and vibrancy and life and love into his art, and I wanted to see that, like I wanted to see like a celebration of joy that he's capable of, and we just got like weird spider monsters, and you know, we got a couple of things in there. It was pretty cool, but yeah. And I followed him on DeviantArt back when that was a thing. It still is, but when it was relevant.
So did I. Absolutely, man. No, I was there looking, and in fact, it's great. A lot of his work is still there.
Yeah, yeah. Love. I remember being like, "Oh, I'm gonna favorite that, and that." Like, I have this great. It's a pencil sketch of him and of Spider-Man and Doctor Strange, and I'm like, "Oh, where is this book?" Sadly, we're never gonna get it. But could be a type. Could be a cover. We got this wonderful, I think one of his last published works was like 50% of a What If comic. What if the new Fantastic Four Part 2. And that was a treasure that I really enjoyed. Just a really fun, goofy story. It's such a great comic for if you want to like see some of his work, because it's just a whole bunch of goofy stuff you'd never see in any other context, and it's a lot of fun.
That's great.
Yeah. Yeah, one of the things I'm sorry, I'm gonna just say a couple of things. Is we were planning Baltimore Comic-Con so many weeks ago and months ago, putting together this virtual event. And the very first thing, the most important thing, the folks at Baltimore Comic-Con, especially Mark, who runs and owns Baltimore Comic-Con, is the Ringos. And it wasn't just to you know, turn this thing into a fun, crazy circus. He said it has to be respectful. It has to be, you know, honor the memory of this great guy. And then the more we started having these conversations, he, in our weekly meetings, used to share all of his stories. And I mean, there wasn't a dry eye in the house of how many lives Mike Ringo touched. And then, John, to see some of the testimonials that you're going to be showing a little bit later on in this broadcast are just phenomenal. I mean, like everybody in the industry. We threw up the flag and said, hey, does anybody want to say anything? And they answered with vigor. I mean, they were just sending you videos and testimonials and stuff. And you're going to see all of that over the next couple hours. And try not to cry.
Yeah, for real, man. No, I hear you. Christy, did you ever meet him?
I'm here. No, I did not. Good friends with his brother and sister-in-law, but I never got to meet him.
Understood. You know, and it's funny, Chuck, as you say, the Ringos are such an important part of the Baltimore Comic-Con. And actually, why don't we start off with Mark Nathan and Mike's brother, Matt, explaining the origin of the Ringo Awards. So here's that video, everybody.
All right. So a handful of years ago, we were separating ourselves from a previous award ceremony. And for a handful of months, we didn't really know what to do. When I say we, there was a bunch of us talking about it. We didn't know really what we were going to do, but we knew that we wanted to do something. We knew we had every mechanism to continue with celebrating on Saturday night at the Baltimore Comic-Con, a form of award. And we talked about a bunch of things, but shortly after Free Comic Book Day of that year, which was what, Matt, 5 years ago, something like that. I don't even know how many we've done, to tell you the truth. Four or five of them. I had Shelly, my wife, contact Suzanne, Matt's wife, and said, this was probably the Tuesday after Free Comic Book Day, that I needed to come down there to Richmond to have dinner to talk to Matt because I had to talk to him in person. In the time of those couple of days, I even had a logo designed that was really all that I had to go with Matt except our general idea. And I got to the restaurant and Matt had no idea what I wanted or anything. All I did was across the table, slide my phone over to him and showed him the logo that we designed for the award ceremony that we thought about. And I think, Matt, you said yes almost immediately, a second later. And we had no idea anything about how we were going to do the awards, or we knew what we had done in the past and we knew that it had a lot of flaws and we knew how to fix those flaws. But I also knew that I wanted fans involved and lots of other things. And one other thing that I remember specifically from those early moments was that Matt's phone had the back cover case was Nova. And that specific year we were honoring Marv Wolfman, which really helped suck Matt into it. It was like that he couldn't get to do that. And there was a lot of things that I thought about at that time, because knowing Mike, I never thought that he would want this kind of attention. And I asked that about Matt. And Matt, you can talk more about it, how you said that at the time that Mike actually started talking about what kind of legacy he was going to live or leave. And I don't know too much about that, but go ahead.
Yeah, that was one of the things that Mike and I had talked about. It was probably 2 or 3 years before he passed away, was that he felt like he had a great career up till now, but he was worried about where his career was going. He felt like I think his contract at Marvel was probably winding down. He didn't know what he was going to do after that, and he was really, really worried about not only his career, but maybe after he was gone, how people would remember him. You know, he really, really respected and admired the giants in the industry, and he just felt like he wasn't going to be able to live up to that. And I kept reminding him, you know, what about Telus? Telus is gonna live long after you. But yeah, this was one of the things that was preying on his mind a lot.
As we've done this, and I'm sure you have too, Matt, by setting up at shows and talking to people, Mike touched so many people, like every day. So many people. So many people have come to me and talked about what he meant to them, and how grateful that they are that we do this once a year.
Yeah, he had imposter syndrome really badly. He had no idea.
I know that I'll share this. I know that at most conventions, Mike would get up and walk around Artist Alley and buy a bunch of mini comics and small publishers and anything he could find. And I always thought that he was just doing it to be nice and introduce himself and talk to everybody. But you told me that he was just looking for new ways of doing things and try to learn all the time.
Oh yeah. Yeah. He had an entire shelf in his studio was comic books that he couldn't read because they were all from Europe, because, you know, he didn't want to just be, you know, learning from people that were doing the exact same thing he was doing. He wanted to go out and find stuff that maybe he could pick and maybe incorporate into his own style. And you can see his style evolved from, I don't know what you would call when he first started out doing the Flash, but it's completely different from what he was doing when he passed away. And it was because he was bringing in a lot of animation, a lot of European styles, some manga, anything he could get his hands on.
And while he was doing that, that's when he was touching so many people's lives. He met so many people while he was doing that. He had no idea how many friends he was making along the way, just by being himself and walking around and talking to people.
I was at one show and he took me over to somebody and introduced. I won't mention the name of the book, but I wasn't making a lot of money, so I didn't have a lot of money to spend. And he introduced me to the guy, and he was like, "You should buy this book." And I said, "Oh, okay, well, I'll think about it." I said, "Don't be a jerk, buy the book." So I went ahead and bought the book, and I'm glad I did. It was gorgeous.
Well, there you go. So when we left the restaurant and we started talking about that, and I told you that I was like 50-50. I didn't know if you would say yes or not. And you said, "What? Really? Why would you think that?" And that's when I said that, you know, I thought Mike was reserved and he wouldn't want this kind of attention. Do you remember what you said after that?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I said that he absolutely would not want us to do this, but F him, he wasn't here. He didn't get a vote.
Yeah. To that, you said, "Well, he's dead and he can yell at us the next time he sees us."
Yes.
Yeah, that was pretty good. So what you don't know was driving home from there, I started calling and texting people for the ride home, telling them what we did and tried to get them involved. And there were people simple as Mark Wade or Philip Sablik. And Philip called me. He was at a thing with his daughter. And he said, "You know, Mike was the first professional I had ever met." And I said to Philip, I was like, "Yeah, you're probably the only person that ever has that story to tell. Like, get in line, buddy." But it was actually Tom Brevoort who said, "Hey, this is great and all, but you can't do this in name only. You have to do this in the spirit of Mike." And that kind of brought me back, like, okay, now it's real. Now we have to really think about this. And that's what really created that spirit award that we give every year that you guys vote about and think about that. I make you get you to work and do part of this too. But what's that process like when you have to go through all that stuff and think about it? I think without saying about anything about this year's was easy, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. They're never easy because it's, you can't really just pick one. There's so many good books out there and I think the thing that we think about when we're choosing the winner is, would Mike like this book? Would he want to work on it? And would he be envious of the people that got to work on it? And would, you know, my wife likes to talk about how my wife, Suzanne, likes to talk about how whenever she wanted a new book to read, she would go to Mike and he would recommend a book for her.
Hmm.
And so that's always in the back of my mind. Like, would Mike recommend this to somebody? And this year's winner, definitely, he would definitely want to have worked on it for various reasons we'll get into at the show. But there were a couple of other books this year that we thought were real contenders, but this one really stood out.
That's great. So Suzanne hasn't written it or read anything in a decade?
No, but she does read the winners.
Oh, good.
And, you know, there are a lot of submissions, and we also go by what we're looking at on the stands, what we can see ourselves. But she, usually, but we'll try to think, like, what would Mike have recommended? Usually it's a lot of Terry Moore stuff.
That's great. So what are your memories right after I left? What happened after that? What did you tell Suzanne?
I went until I got home to talk to her. The first thing I thought was, if I'd known you were going to be bringing that up, because I thought that you were coming down to tell me we couldn't do the show anymore, that you needed the table, but you wanted to tell me in person. The first thing that occurred to me was, wow, if I'd known that this was what he wanted to talk about, I would have taken him to a nicer place, because
it was terrible. It was fine.
But yeah, I was excited. I was a little nervous. We joke about what I said when you asked me, you know, how Mike would have felt about it. But that really has or was on my mind a lot the days after that. But, you know, ever since then, it's kind of the load is kind of lightened up, because people's reaction to it has been so positive that I think he would have been okay with it at this point. Still, I do know Mike, and he would have been like, anytime somebody talked about him in a positive light, he'd have been like, shut up.
Right.
Because he did have that imposter syndrome, and he would be thinking, you know, why me? But why not?
But all they have to do would be in the room 1 year and they'll see it.
Yeah.
It's pretty obvious every year.
Yeah.
Huh. What else do you remember? Anything else that you want to share?
I do remember that my hands were shaking, because it was a little bit of a heavy responsibility, because I do feel like I need to look out for Mike's legacy, because he's not here to do it. And I do joke a lot. You know, Todd and Craig, you can thank them for that.
Sure.
For starting that. But we, you know, we tend to joke a lot about, you know, what would Mike want? And, you know,
I've been part of those.
But I really do not want to do anything that Mike would kill me for if he were here. So I, you know, I try to do everything as cautiously as possible, but I think he would be pretty happy with this. I think he'd be pretty proud of it.
I hope we're doing him pretty well by what we're doing.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think so. You got to find us some more art so we can use it continually. Change the art.
I know. Well, he's not making any more, so it gets a little harder every year.
Deep. I'm sure that if we spread the word that we're looking for sketches or something to use, I'm sure there's a lot of people out there that can share them with us.
Oh, yeah. He used to do all those head sketches and a lot of stuff for free.
Yeah.
Right now, I guess we're trying to limit it to Telus for rights reasons. But
I got a really good Donald Duck we could use one day.
Well, you've got connections. Maybe talk to your friends at Marvel and DC and see what they'll let us
use. Yeah, well. You hear that, Tom? We want to use some Marvel art one day. All right. Well, so it's a week from today. We're actually taping this for the red carpet, but this is the Saturday before. I know all the winners, but I'm not going to tell anybody. But this is going to be a very, very good, exciting night. There's going to be a lot of things that people aren't going to be expecting, I think. It's going to be a lot of fun. Are you guys ready with your delivery?
I believe so. You'll have to talk to Todd about that. He's
Todd wrote it. So you guys have to have four guys on your call, right, to do it.
Uh-oh, you're breaking up a little bit.
You are too, but you have like four guys on your call. That's going to be a little tougher.
Oh yeah, yeah. I'll probably be doing it upstairs on my work computer.
Uh-huh.
And I'm right directly under the Wi-Fi, so it should help out a little bit there.
You get to do it live.
Yeah.
You wear the same shirt.
No, we have something else in mind.
Oh, very good. See, that's exciting already. All right.
It won't be this shirt.
Okay. That's a great shirt, though.
There you go, everybody. How about that?
Yeah, that's really nice. Yeah.
That was great.
Well, and again, I mean, it's all sincere. I mean, Matt and his wife judged the Spirit Award in particular. And God, you know, we're going to see a lot of great tributes from a lot of our friends, people like Cully Hamner and Scotty Young and Jeff Parker and Jeff Lemire and Tom King, Mark Wade. It's Jamar Nichols, unbelievable guys, Richard Case as well.
Yeah.
And these are all guys. They were former studio mates of Mike and longtime friends. And yeah, I mean, that is the great thing. I mean, truly, all of the award shows, the comic award shows, are picked for exceptional people, you know. And agreed, Scott, you did a great job in the last hour, Scott Dunbeer from IDW. yeah, you know, I mean, that's the thing, man. These people that work with Mike and stuff, they know, and I know they all feel a deep love for Mike and everything. And again, he was one of a kind. And what I started to say was the fact that. You know, the Eisners, obviously, Will Eisner, you know, the legend speaks for himself. They were the Kirby Awards before they were the Eisner Awards.
Yeah, yeah, and, right.
And, you know, while he was alive, Will would sit on stage and be able to hand out the Eisners directly. Len, let me acknowledge what Len is saying right here. These two names I always hear were the nicest people in comics ever, Len Wein and Mike Waringo. I agree. And yeah. I would add for the living nicest men in comics, Dave Gibbons and Walter Simonson to that team picture.
Absolutely.
Yep.
So, and of course, you know, Harvey Kurtzman, named for, you know, the Harvey Awards named for him. And again, another great mentor to so many, like Mike was.
Yeah.
And it was just a natural choice when Baltimore decided to keep, you know, they used to host the Harveys.
That's
and,
right.
And now, you know, when they were looking for somebody new, it's a great choice. You couldn't find anybody better than Mike.
Absolutely. Now, I remember when they launched the Ringos, and I was just thinking, like, yeah, like there was no confusion, there was no you know, issue about it. I was like, yeah, that's a lovely idea. I, you know, Mike Waringo was a prolific, incredibly talented artist, lovely person, and like you said, touched so many different people that it would, yeah. You know, that what are the qualifiers do you need, really? You know, to get a and. You know, and I like the idea of there being a nice variety of comic award shows, you know, or not shows, but awards themselves, like mm-hmm. actually being able to, you know, just create a different kind of variety. I like this show and I like this award. I think it's just, I think it really represents like the spirit of not just the convention, because of course Mike was intrinsically connected with the Baltimore Comic-Con, but also like the, you know, the spirit of Mr. Wingrove's art and his, you know, His career.
Well, go ahead, Kirstie.
Well, I was just going to say, I can tell you at the first Ringo Awards, there was not a dry eye in the house almost the entire time.
Yeah.
You know, there was laughter, but there were tears.
Of course.
They're all, you know, I really wish that I could have met him.
Yeah.
Well, as Chuck said earlier, I think some of these testimonials will make you laugh and also might make you cry as well. Absolutely.
Yeah. For sure.
I was going to ask you both, for the writers that he worked with, who do you think were the exceptional ones? I can think of a couple names, but I want to hear what you guys say first.
Absolutely. Chris, do you want to go first?
I can.
I don't want to. I just talked. I'm like, yeah, you go ahead.
It's okay. I think that his work with Mark Wade was exceptional.
Sure.
And I think it's really great when an artist and a writer, you know, mesh and they become friends. I saw that today in the Donnie Cates and Ryan Stegman panel, where you can just tell by reading their work why it's so good, because they just mesh.
Yeah.
And I know that they, you know, they were great friends, and I think that that work was just, it was truly exceptional.
Yeah.
This is going a little bit into like kind of hokey territory, but getting off the heels of the Clone Saga it was a really, really, it was such a welcome breath of fresh air to get Todd DeZago and Mike's sensational Spider-Man run. Just such a different kind of book. And that was, I think, the first book that introduced me to his art. I was like, ooh, this guy really knows how to draw some fun Spider-Man. And you know, you got a lot of really silly, fun stuff. You got like the Swarm and all the Norman Osborn stuff, but like there's a lot of really fun stuff in there. And I think his just getting the opportunity to showcase his versatility, because of course when you're doing any good Spider-Man book, you get the high-flying superheroics in action, but you also get the human component, and he could do both expertly. Yeah. You know, it was just, it popped right off the page, and you were completely enthralled from beginning to end. And so that was my first introduction, but it has a special place in my heart for that run.
Understood. I agree with both of your choices, and in fact, regarding Todd, you know, he with Telos, you know, so beyond the Marvel work and stuff, it was great that they got into the creator-owned arena, and you know, and yeah, Telos is such a great fantasy story, a great all-ages story, and I know how much it meant to a lot of the other creators, and it's been great to see the tributes to Mike through Telos that have come out subsequently after his passing. But for me, it's Dan Slott, and I really enjoyed their collaborations, especially when they paired Spider-Man and the Human Torch.
Yeah.
Because really, Mike brought the fun and the bounciness that you wanted in those kinds of adventures and misadventures. And, you know, Dan gets Johnny Storm and Peter Parker in ways that, you know, that's why they're friends, the two characters. Yeah. And it's just always really great. It's kind of the two knuckleheads that, you know, end up screwing up half the time. Mm-hmm. And so it was always the joy in those miniseries when the two, Ringo and Slott got together.
Yeah.
So yeah. Let's see what's going on in the comments. We got any other thoughts here? No, not right now. That's fine. I just saw some new things. They're in their own world chatting, but that's totally fine. I can play another a great tribute right now. Let's hear from Jamar Nichols.
Hey everybody, Jamar Nichols here with my cat Beatrice. Say hi, Beatrice. Yeah, she says hello. I just wanted to give a little moment to talk about my dear pal Mike Waringo. Mike meant a lot to all of us, and I'm very appreciative that I was asked to say some words about him for the Ringo Awards. So I wanted to share a little story, and it's funny that my cat is here. So one time Mike and I were talking. He talked to everybody in comics on the phone every day. I don't know how he did that, but we were talking one day, and a lot of people know that he had a bad back. So he was remarking on how he just bought a new bed. And he bought one of those number pedic beds. And the story kind of goes is I'm kind of making fun of him about that. And if you know anything about those beds, that it changes the hardness or softness levels depending on who's on what side, and you can adjust your number level. So he was talking about this bed and how much he enjoyed it. And I asked him if his cat Charlie had a number. And he laughed and said, no, I don't let the cat on the bed. And then he stopped and said, okay, it's 86. So that's one of my funny stories about Mike. And, you know, he loved animals and, one of the greatest things that I remember about him is how caring he was with everyone around him, especially animals. So I pet my cat in tribute to our dear bud Mike. By thy side. Thanks.
How sweet.
Nice. Yeah. 86. That's great. 86. Sort of a sleeper. Yeah. I used to do those commercials in my radio days. A sleep number bed from Serta, of course.
Sleep number.
Absolutely, yep. Man. Hilarious. That's fantastic. Yeah, it's good. It's good to know. Good to know that. That might be a good tip for the pet channel.
Right.
If you want to let your pet sleep comfortably. Take it from Jamar. That's outstanding. Yeah. Man, you know, we are less than 90 minutes away from the Ringo Awards. And I do want to remind everybody that the show is going to open up with Kevin Smith comments. And then we're also going to have a keynote speech from Jeff Johns. Very heartfelt. Awesome. And I'm really looking forward to that. And I'm looking forward to these nominees and seeing who wins. It's going to be a fun award show.
It's a great group this year. Well, it's a great group every year, but this year it's a really, really, I couldn't, when I voted, I was like, I don't even know who to vote for. I love them all.
Yeah, read my mind, Chuck. Absolutely. Todd DeZago, the great collaborator on Telos, commenting, great story. Absolutely, hey. Man. So great to see you, Todd. I hope Todd's going to be on the awards later and stuff. And yeah, I bet the cat howled if it was on the wrong number. I have no doubt. You know what's funny? Pet story. Talking to Susan Eisenberg this afternoon, and all of a sudden I hear this howling, and I'm like, "Oh, it's her dog Oliver, this lovely yellow lab, it's a beautiful dog." And I'm like, "Oh, that's Oliver, isn't it?" She's like, "He's asleep, and he's howling in his sleep."
Oh my god!
And I do love that. That is always my favorite moment, is watching your pet sleeping and then kicking in the air or making noise or whatever. So yeah, I mean, that just shows you, man. There's something going on in that head, you know.
That's right.
Which is kind of beautiful.
Susan and I trade dog pictures weekly.
that are not yours, I assume. That are from the world.
No, they're all ours.
Oh, that's nice.
I have many pictures.
My wife and I do the same thing with our cats, where I'm like, hey, I bet you didn't see one of our cats from this angle.
Yeah.
You know,
my dog's sleeping here. Now he's turned here.
Yeah. And it's always like red letter news. Like, it's always real. Like, oh, that's a high priority. Like,
yeah. Oh, look, he twitched.
Can you take a video? Oh, they left.
That's awesome. You know, again, you know, we shouldn't, we were talking about his Marvel work. Let's not forget all the great DC work.
True enough.
That, you know, he's done over the years as well. Great Superman artist at a very important time in the late 90s into the early 2000s. Of course, my God, what a run on The Flash. And, when you hear Mark's tribute, he'll certainly talk about his Flash run. Yeah, man. I mean, really. And am I right, Christy? Isn't Mike the co-creator of Impulse?
Yes. Yes.
That's dope.
His first sketch was he was, and again, it's like he brought that joy. You know, Impulse is just a very joyful character. And the one episode where he's, you know, going through and everything's happening, he's causing havoc everywhere. It's just, you can tell just you can tell that there was joy when he was drawing it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So. I'm sorry. He didn't get a chance to see Bart played out in, Smallville as far back as that, and Young Justice and all the different iterations we've gotten of Bart. It's kind of a shame. I wonder what he would have thought of that in one period too, when they aged Bart, and he had taken over as the third Flash, really,
right.
in that mm-hmm. brief moment. I think I'm glad that DC thought better of it, because Bart. Well, you know, again, the characters really, you know, Jay, Barry, Wally, and Bart, they really are so distinct, and Max as well, throwing Max in there as well.
Oh, yeah, Mercury.
So.
Barry.
Yeah, no, I agree. I remember when Impulse was like when he debuted. I remember that iconic image where it's like maskless when he's running at the front of the cover and just that character being like, I'm like, gee, I remember as a kid being like, geez, another Flash, and then getting the introduction to the character, I'm like, oh, okay, like this is actually kind of fun. Like he's actually embracing kind of like what as a kid you want the Flash to be. And then of course when you put him on a team, even better. Young Justice,
Justice,
like such a great a concept, and couldn't, I don't think it could have worked better without Impulse. Like Impulse added that extra element to that team, to the Trinity, and then of course to the rest of the team. And seeing Bart play off of Connor, who was always in flux as a character, and then of course Tim, who's just a great character. And I think Mike also drew a run on the Tim Drake Robin series as well. Which was also really, really terrific. And because I was also a big Robin fan back in the day. So
very cool.
I read a lot of that, which was, of course, I believe that was a Chuck Dixon inspired book. So Yeah.
Hi, Robert.
All your peeps are coming out, Christy. That's awesome.
It's very Baltimore, nice. Baltimore,
this is a tough weekend for so many people because Baltimore is, it's not just a convention. It's a family reunion, but with family that you love. it's been really hard. I've talked to Mark and Shelley many, many times and Tom Zoller, and it's, you know, we're all just, it just, it's a hard weekend. It's, I didn't think it was going to be as tough as it is. I couldn't even delete it from my calendar because I'm like, no, it's still there. But then all the Facebook memories show up and, you know, right. There's the Walt last year at the Ringo's, and last year I was a judge for the Ringo's. So.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. That's and,
awesome. You don't talk, well, yeah, I want to hear about that, Christy, honestly.
Unless you're on a get order.
I never get to hear like the process and stuff. How many, how many books do you, do you have to read to judge?
9 million.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that, only that?
Books after boxes showed up. And then at one point I met, Mark and Shelley at a show so that I could just get the, we could just transfer the boxes in the car. There were so many, many of them I'd already read because, you know, I own a comic shop, so I try to read as much as I can.
Plug the comic shop.
I'm sorry?
Plug the comic shop.
Oh, yeah, Comics Muncie.
Represent, absolutely.
It's awesome. It is awesome. Oh, yeah, like with Robert, it's just a little side. It's like I go to their table and Sam and I build a Lego set every year. You know, it's just these little things that just mean so much.
Sure.
There were so many books to read and just there's so much talent. And then you have to decide. And it's not just those books. You know, that's just the ones that they send you. But there's all these other ones, too. And then all the web series. But it really does open your world. There is a book that I never read before or heard about, Woman World, last year. And I just fell in love with it. And I just, cool. I recommend it to everybody that comes in the store. I'm like, here, look what I have. Just because it's so good. I just felt, I was so happy. Yeah. I don't have any more Deadpool stuff, Emily. You bought it all. no, but it was such an honor. And we had so much fun. And, you know, I got to hang out with Katie Cook and she was at our table. We drank wine together. lots of it. it was so hard to judge, but it was so much fun to judge, but it's hard to pick that one. I'm like, can I just pick all of these? No, but we did get to pick the top, you know, the top numbers. So I didn't have to decide 100%, but
good.
You did have to rank them, which was difficult.
Sure. Yeah, I can't. What criteria did you use to measure? You know, when you have a word like best, you know, like how do you measure best, particularly when it comes to something as subjective as art?
Yeah, and it's which day is it? You know.
Yeah, exactly. How do you feel today? Right.
It's like because like, and there's books that mean different things to you at different times, like Day Tripper, Fabian Moon, and Gabriel Ball,
the brothers. Sure.
It is a fabulous book, but I've read it at different times in my life and it means completely different things at different times. And so, you know, it depends on your mood and you only have so long. So you have to like really cram things in. So I was trying not to like judge things if I'm really tired that day or have a migraine, you know, I'm like, okay, I can't read these because I don't want to not like this book because I'm in a bad mood.
That's good.
But you know, I also teach, so I have to do that with teaching too. You know, with reading the same paper over and over and over.
Oh
again.
Yeah.
And you're just like, please stop.
Oh my God, no. Well, what grade level do you teach?
I taught in college.
Okay, all right. So. I taught high school, so it's you have a much more stringent criteria by which you have to measure your students. Because I was like, every time you read a paper or you read an essay, it's just like. Right, they don't know. Like, they don't know how it works. So, how do you, you know? But that's interesting, though, because I can imagine taking an analytical process like teaching and applying it to, you know, measuring and grading and of course judging art. You know, you're basically doing the same thing because you're like, okay, when you see the name, you go, okay, I know what their skill level is. I know what their attention level is. I know what their like what their level of you know of achievement is. So you have to judge it differently. You know, from essay to essay. It's why it's like a hard job, because you can't just go, well, you screwed up 16, you know, contractions. There you go. Like, here's your C. You know, you can't do that. You got to measure it all by each person. And here's a question, though. When it comes to measuring art, is there a situation where you've read someone's work where you're like, oh, I didn't like this one as much as I've liked their previous work? And what do I do in that situation? What do you do in that situation?
Well, it's kind of weird, because it depends on, some people just work better with other people. When the artist and the writer get each other, you know, it's perfect. You know, I mean, I can understand Grant Morrison's writing when he's with a really good artist, but sometimes it's too, when the artist doesn't get him, it takes me like 3 or 4 times to read it. Cause you know, cause he's just brilliant. And right. I'm not. So
don't sell yourself short. Sometimes
he's impenetrable. Well, he's on a whole different level.
That's true.
So, and you know, everybody has their own art style that they like and their own, you know, styles. And so, but you know, little things like since I did the Donnie Cates and Ryan Stegman panel, so I really went back and looked at all of the Venom and Absolute Carnage, and the coloring and Absolute, the colorist in Absolute Carnage was brilliant. And absolutely, I didn't know that it was all him until today.
Me either.
Well, when he walks in and sees Peter Parker, it's all dark and at night and rainy, the whole series. And then when he meets Peter Parker, the whole color palette changes.
Yeah.
It's bright. And I was just like, it's brilliant.
Right.
You know, it was great. So, and I also know, you know, how hard it is to write, because, you know, I've written before also. Yep. So it's, you know, so sometimes I'm like, oh, I know how tough this is. And it was really difficult, because, you know, some art style is just not my style, but you have to judge it, you know, without those biases.
Exactly.
And some art is like super simple. And that Woman World book I was talking about, the art is very simple, but it's so expressive that it just kind of blew me away. And so it's a very difficult job, but it was so much fun, and I wouldn't trade that experience for the world.
But I would say that regarding judging on things that are yearly, you got to judge the book at the moment, what's nominated. Yes. And as great as, you know, any named writer or artist is, how did you do it? I mean, how'd you do this season? I mean, I'll put it in my sports metaphors, given my years in sports and stuff. And it's, you know, we're only worried about who's the best at this moment.
Yeah.
And I feel that way about movies and television as well.
Oh, sure.
I mean, again, big name actors, big name directors and writers. But, you know, it's about the project of the moment. And a lot of times you will get people that almost get consolation awards for their body of work. Because, like, you know, I remember the year that Charles Durning, as a great character actor, was nominated for the Mel Brooks movie To Be or Not to Be. And we're all like, that's because everybody screwed up and he should have been at least nominated last year for his performance in Tootsie. That was the award-winning performance. But again, it's subjective, and depending on how big the jury judges are, you know, that kind of determines what kind of pool of opinions you're getting.
That's fair,
And there's things like Saga that I love so much, but it's like, okay, I have to judge these issues.
Yes.
Not this. Because I think Saga has one of the greatest panels ever in history. But I'm like, okay, I can't judge it on that. You have to judge it from here up. So it's like, oh, how can I do that? So you just really have to separate yourself. But it was an experience, but oh my gosh. I mean, boxes kept arriving. And my kids are like, you're going to read all that? And I'm like, yeah.
I gotta.
You'll see me in 3 weeks, you know.
No, I understand. Let's play another tribute to Mike.
Yes.
You know, Matt and Mark were talking about, got to collect more original art from people who've bought it over the years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And here's Tom King with a really interesting story about that.
Nice. Hi, I'm Tom King. I write comics for a living, and I am and was a huge Ringo fan, so much so I've told this story before, so you poor people have to listen to it. I at my first Baltimore Comic-Con, first con I ever went to, I bought a Ringo page, and I felt like it made my year a little better. Like it was like almost a lucky thing. I bought this page right here. And so I went back the next year and bought another Ringo page. And every single Comic-Con that I've Baltimore, every year I buy one Ringo page, just sort of a blessing of my entire year, just to be like, this year is going to go great. And I just, they're just brilliant. They're brilliant, beautiful work. And I keep them with me always. And it's sort of a sign of just the love of pure comic booking, which is what Ringo was. So I did that every single year for, you know, many, many years. Until last year, because I had some sort of eye infection and, you know, the con was going by and I had panels to go to. And I just missed it and I forgot. And I was like, okay, well, 1 year, 2020, I won't, you know, buy my Ringo page this year and I won't sort of pay my respects to the Ringo God. But it'll be fine. I'm sure 2020 will turn out okay, despite my actions. So I'm mostly here to apologize. It's all my fault. I should have bought the fucking page. And I as soon as the world stops ending, I'll buy the next one. Thank you so much for honoring the legacy of Ringo and his brilliant cartooning. Thank you so much to all the fans out there. It's much appreciated.
There you go. Tom King. He can't help it.
Tom did it.
I wish I were in a position to be able to just go, oh, I would love, because I never got into the original art game, but I would like to, and every once in a while, like, I'll go on, like, an auction site or one of the dealers, and I'll just take a look, and I'm like, anything in my price range? And of course not, because, like, it's art. It's not, like, a thing, the thing you can get at Target, you know, it's something someone created, and there it is, and it'll be there long after I'm gone. Mm-hmm. I did get one piece of original art, like an actual page from a comic book, but it wasn't a Mike Ringo. And I wish it were, because man, would I like to have something of Mike's that's, you know, but it's such in short supply. There's like, there's no way. Anybody who wants it, like they, you know, you gotta really hunt for it or know somebody.
And I'm glad Tom Zoller's watching.
Yes, Tom Zoller's watching.
Absolutely.
Tom's the greatest.
Tom's awesome, absolutely.
I'm sure he's drinking wine also.
I think you're right about that. Len, the Englishman of San Diego, says he was part of the judging panel for the Tripwire Awards.
Ooh,
nice.
And those are great British awards. One of the hardest things he's ever done and one of the most rewarding. Very cool. Awesome. Yeah. And that's funny. You know, someone's asking, was that Weird Science 22 behind Tom? It was. That is absolutely... Tom has really gotten into collecting the very classic Golden Age comics. It's pretty amazing. I've seen him buy some original, they're not originals, but Frazettas with like from the Golden Age.
Frazetta. No.
Oh, yeah.
We talked to him the other day, and he had you could see it in the high. And after like about 45 minutes of talking, he was like, he was like, all right, you want to see some of the stuff I got back here? And I'm like, yes, I would. Please bring the camera closer. He's like, no, I'll just tell you what's back there.
Yeah, I mean, Sal, I did that with you.
You did.
These very images that we saw right there on stuff while we were talking on Word Balloon, definitely.
Yeah.
If my back wasn't killing me right now, you'd see some of my original art.
I know, and I've seen it over your shoulder, and I've been meaning to ask, like, okay, what's this, what's that? Because, you know, like, if it's got to be something, you know, really, really special. I mean,
I don't buy pages. I do like getting commissioned pieces, because to me that's almost like asking, you know, a rock star to sing a song for you specifically.
Totally.
That's how I always look at it. So I've been very fortunate because, you know, I've become friends with a lot of the artists, so they give me a nice rate. I would never, I mean, some have gifted me, which is incredibly kind, but it's like, look, man, this is your living. I would never, you know, insult you that way.
Totally.
But, exactly, you know. Tom Zoller.
So there you go, man.
I don't, very funny. I only have some original art. Hi, Jamar.
Jamar, I don't know if you saw, we just played your tribute.
Yeah, we just played. But I do have things like this.
No.
Oh. Hey, and you know, honestly, Chrissy, you did earlier. Oh. And again, everybody, if you miss panels, right now we've got the streams up, but eventually we are going to chop them up in panel by panel, and we will have those on the website.
Okay,
they'll be at Word Balloon. They'll be at Mainframe. They'll be at Comic Core. All of these places. I don't know. Chuck, I don't know if you're going to have them at Chuck Loda Comics or not, are you? I don't know. Oh, he's got the thumbs up. Yes, he is.
All right, excellent
to hear. But Kristen, you got a chance to talk to Louise Simonson.
I did, and
the subject of that great cover of House of Secrets.
Yes, this is like her first comic work, you know.
Yeah.
And Bernie is just, he's my favorite.
He was amazing.
Yes.
And Swamp Thing is my favorite, so of DC. But oh my gosh, Louise is if you want to talk about the kindest people in comics, you know, if you say Walter, you've got to say Wheezy also.
Yes.
She is, I mean, she's just, seriously, she just makes the world a better place. Yeah. And she's a joy. And I'm sure she has bad days, but you wouldn't know it because she's just always kind and she's so talented and she doesn't realize how talented she is.
Yeah.
But she's beautiful and she's talented and she's sweet. It just, she's like what I aspire to attempt to be. I won't be that. I can attempt.
You see Dean Haspel's quote that he's home alone shirtless. You better have a shirt on tomorrow, Dean, when you're doing your panels. Dean did a great job on Friday night moderating Walt Simonson and Bill Sienkiewicz.
Yeah.
And Howard Chaykin and Dennis Cowan.
The hell of a show.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
It was hilarious. Absolutely. But then Dean is going to be on Dean's going to be on these two panels, and then let's talk about those guys. Dean's got the Autobio panel. About autobiographical comics, and Dean has been amazing with his work over the years doing that. Not only his own stories, but other people that he's worked with, like Harvey Pekar and others. But then he's also going to be on the webcomics panel, and that's terrific. And, man, I'll tell you, the Red Hook continues to deliver year after year. It's a tremendous, tremendous book.
Dean is one of the most talented people and also one of the nicest people. And, you know, he doesn't have enough shirts, but that's okay. So he's just amazing, and I dearly miss him. I was looking through my Baltimore pictures, and I'm like, "There's Dino. I don't get to see him this year."
And Jamar,
precious.
Yes, indeed. And Jamar is one of our presenters too in the Kids Love Comics wing as well, and we'll have interviews and other things going on tomorrow during the kids hours. Again, we suggest you go to BaltimoreComicConLive.com for the schedule.
I don't think people realize how amazing and lucky they are to have all of these creators do these panels and be happy to, because they just want to be a part of Baltimore. And kudos to Mark and Shelley for making this show what it is, because I'm trying not to cry. I've been going about 10 years now, and it's something that I can't even describe what it means to me and to people. It's just something that I would move heaven and earth to get to.
Yeah.
And I don't even want to go to the store right now, but if they said we're going to have Baltimore, I'd go. I take my chances. Because it means so much to so many people and all of my family's there, and I miss them dearly.
No, I get it. Absolutely, buddy. I mean, it's and that really is the hallmark of Baltimore, and that's, I think, why it stays such a distinct show, is because it's the comic book love fest. It really is.
Yeah,
it is.
We all love San Diego. San Diego is its own thing. We there you go, man. Absolutely. Baltimore Comic-Con is family. No, you're right, man. And New York is fun because it's New York, and I mean, you're right there, the heart of the heartbeat of America, if you will. But
exactly.
But really, Baltimore remains this amazing comic-centric show. And that's why a lot of the creators come back and support it. I would say Baltimore and Heroes Con. So you know. So there you go.
I'd like to point out that Tom Zoller, I am not a wimp. He just said you're starting to cry, you're a wimp. I'm not. Back off.
It's all right.
Yeah.
It's quite all right.
I bet he's crying.
Yeah. I can't believe just what an amazing show it turned out to be, because I remember hearing about it because I have family down in Virginia, and it's like, I from Jersey to Virginia, you know, you have to pass through Baltimore.
Sure.
And I was like, oh, that sounds cool. Yeah, I checked that out back when, like, I was getting the bug, 2006. I was like, oh, I guess I'll check that out. You know, go down 2006. I was like, and it's halfway to Virginia. I used to drive down to Virginia in a day. 3 hours difference. That's great. That's a day trip for me. 3 hours down, 3 hours back. No big deal. First time I went, not only did I have an amazing time, But as I told John last time, I was like, and that'll be the last time I make it a full day. Like, I'm gonna get a hotel. I remember when we went down, I was like, oh, can we get a hotel now? And it was like, no. It is booked solid. What a great location, what a great experience. I took in so much of that show, and the amount of creators, the caliber of creators, the fact that it's not overwhelmed by any of the nonsense you get from the bigger shows, but it has all the right components of a big show that you're just like, it is addictive and it is infectious. I mean, who doesn't want to, like, you go to the show, you go to the Inner Harbor, you get like some amazing food, you go back to the show, you know, like, it's for me, like, one of my fondest con memories is I was sitting at a restaurant across the street from the convention center, like literally across the street. Of course, it was in the fall, but it was one of those usual fall days we get over the last 20 years where it was like 80 degrees, and I'm sitting there at the table, I'm having an amazing sandwich, and I'm drinking something, and just looking over, and there's the show, and there's amazing, these cosplayers, just what a beautiful experience this is, and like, I just really enjoy it. And then a friend of mine from Bad Idea, Dinesh, comes by, and I'm like, oh, hey, Dinesh, come here, and we, you know, we just talk for about 10 minutes, you know, and then I go back to the show, and just, it's, what a great time. Oh, I miss it so much.
It's a big town with a small town feeling.
Absolutely. So,
big time.
And yeah, coming from Chicago, no, there's a lot of, it's those working class big cities that are, I think, exceptional like that. And yeah, Baltimore has that vibe. You know, it's funny, I literally haven't been there in 10 years because I started getting invitations to help program shows that were happening around the same time. And this is when I still had a radio job too, especially, it was tough really when I was still in sports, because football season is like, that's the most important time of a sports year.
Yeah.
It really is. And you can't take time off. So no. I would always miss Baltimore. And the last time I was there, it was the 10th anniversary of Powers. Mm. And Bettis and Mike Oming asked me to moderate their panel. It was great. Oh. We had a blast. And it's really nice that we're coming full circle. And Sunday night, to close out Baltimore Comic-Con online, we're going to be doing the Powers 20th anniversary panel with Bendis and Oming and their last graphic novel that just came out. I don't know if you both had a chance to read it. It's fantastic. It wraps up the series incredibly well.
Awesome.
And also, like the series itself, it the final story is 20 years down the road. So you kind of really do get to see this like kind of last bit of where all these great characters are that we've enjoyed for 20 years.
Yeah.
So. More comments from the people, everybody. Let's see. We got, hold on. There it is. Baltimore is the best show to meet your favorite creators and have a real conversation with them. 100%, man. You are correct.
And totally real. Everybody there is real.
Absolutely. Yeah. Nobody goes who's like trying. Yeah. When you go, you know what it is. Like, I lament how popular it has gotten because of what a great, well-kept secret it is, but I want them to succeed. You know, it's one of those things where you're like, no, don't come, but please, like, come. Like, it's, yeah. But even still, the organizers have done a nice job of keeping it moving, keeping it fresh. Like, you know, you stand in line for anyone. 10 minutes, you know, unless it's one of those things where they're only going to be there for like the day or half the day, then it's like a couple hours, but whatever, you know, it's an 8-hour show. You're going to be fine.
here's a brief tribute from one of the top creators and another very approachable creator, Canada's finest. It's Jeff Lemire.
Hey, everybody, this is Jeff Lemire from Toronto, wishing I could be in Baltimore for the Ringo Awards with all of you, but it's still great to be nominated, and it's obviously a great honor to be included with so many great creators and other great comics and to be part of an award ceremony that shares the name of the great Mike Waringo, who was obviously such an inspiration to so many of us. So thanks again, and hopefully we'll be all back in Baltimore together again next year. Thanks.
There you go.
I like that it's like, I am Jeff Lemire from Canada, not from like any of the amazing works you might know me from.
He's one of Canada's favorite
Canada.
Yeah.
It's I love his level of notoriety in Canada, and they absolutely like. It's great that they do acknowledge how great Jeff is. He's got an Essex County TV show in the works. Yeah, I know that. That I don't know how far they got in COVID, but they were shooting this year, and I don't know if they finished principal photography or not. But and that's one of the reasons why Jeff may not be able to join us. I mean, I know he's extremely busy, not only doing his comics, but also the TV stuff that he's gotten the opportunity to do. And I hope Essex County does come down here, and then
he deserves everything good that happens to him. He's just he just brings joy through his work too, even though some of the scary stuff.
Yeah.
Oh my God! Absolutely, well, I'm blanking right now.
Family Tree.
Family Tree, definitely. What's the other one?
AD?
Not AD. It's the current one where...
Not Descender.
The one where...
Descender's great, though.
Descender's excellent. Oh, no, Sweet Tooth, so all these things. But it's the one where it starts as a police procedural, and then there's alternate universes going on, and just crazy stuff. I mean, it's insane, and shame on me that I'm not remembering the title right now. Maybe somebody in the chat will remember what I'm talking about, but good Lord.
But I know which one you're talking about.
It's unbelievable, man. Is Cully in? Oh, hey, there's Cully.
Yeah.
Good to see you, Cully. Cully.
Hi, Cully Hamner.
Why don't we play, man, Cully has a great Ringo story. So let's let Cully tell his Ringo story right now.
My name is Cully Hamner. I am a longtime friend of Mike's. I met him in, I want to say it was probably 1991. He was someone who walked up to me at a convention at Heroes Con in North Carolina. And I had not had anything published yet, but I was sitting with my pals who would later become Gaijin Studios, and they were sort of letting me squat at their table space. So I had my portfolio all laid out and everything, and this tall kind of guy who looked about my age but had gray hair for some reason that I couldn't figure out, walked up to show me his portfolio. And it was the first time I ever reviewed anyone's portfolio, because in my mind, I was not a professional yet. I was not really published yet. And you know, he showed me his portfolio, and it was really good. It was great. It was better than anything that I had. And I just kind of pushed it back to him, and I said, you know, I don't really think that I can help you. you know, you're better than I am. And he really wouldn't hear that, and it turned into this sort of mutual admiration society, and we traded business cards, back when people used to walk around with business cards a lot of the time. And when I got back home to Alabama, and I was still living with my parents at the time, a couple of weeks after that, I got essentially a fan letter from Mike, which was bizarre. It was the first portfolio review I'd ever had, and it was the first fan letter I'd ever had. But his phone number was on the card, so I called him to let him know that I got his card or his letter. And we ended up being on the phone for hours and just discovered that we had a lot in common. And, you know, we made each other laugh, which was to be a habit for the next, 15 or so years that I knew him. Yeah, I guess that's about the right amount of time. You know, we just developed a lifelong friendship, and I was, you know, when he got the Flash, I was super excited for him, and it was like his big break, and we always kind of bucked each other up and supported each other. And it was a truly, great friendship. And it didn't matter how long, it was between us talking to each other, or how much time or how little time there was, we always would pick right back up where we left off. We continue to have like those marathon conversations up until just a couple weeks before we lost him. But he he was just an amazing artist, an amazing storyteller. He and I saw things a lot in a very similar way when it came to what makes a good comic book artist. And I think that we were very complimentary in our personalities and in our styles. I think we influenced each other a lot. That's why I think it's amazing that there's an award for comics named after him, because he was comics. It was in his blood. He breathed comics. He was all about comics. He loved the medium and was great at it. And he contributed a lot to it. And it's the best way that I can see to honor Mike is to have his name on something that is a marker of people who are good at this medium, because he certainly was.
Aww. That was like Ringoception. He had Ringo in his shirt talking about Mike.
Yep. Yeah. Cully's one of my favorite people in comics, and had dinner with Cully and Tom King and Doc Shaner and Mitch Garrett's at C2E2 the last con standing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we'll come back. Don't worry, guys. I mean, and again, that's why we got things like Baltimore Comic-Con online, and it's great to be here, and great that we're able. Thank God we've got this technology. Exactly. Well, so you know, our phone bills would be insane because we're constantly on talking to each other, right?
Also, yeah. It's Gideon Falls. That's what you were
thinking. Thank you.
Of.
Thank you. Exactly.
It came to me as soon as we stopped talking about it.
I knew it would, and that's one of the reasons why I started playing another Ringo tribute. So thank you for looking that up. That was great. Yeah, Gideon Falls is an amazing book. And it's so good. It's just layer upon layer of it's not what you thought it was, and it keeps getting crazier and stranger and stuff. And like you said, Christy, Jeff is this just sweet, mild-mannered guy, Canadian shy, as I like to say. And you know, just what's bubbling under the surface, it's like there's a lot going on there, Jeff Lemire, and you're happy for us, but I'm glad it comes out in these stories.
Yeah. Well, he's got to be quiet because he's got to balance out Zdarsky.
Right. So. Yes. Oh, my God.
God, I love Chip. He's so great. He's terrific.
Great. He's great.
Oh, my God. That's funny. Good stuff, man.
Yeah.
You guys are killing me. let's see. Oh, here's a nice tribute online here, Joezilla. Mike Ringo was one of the first artists, to make me notice motion in comics. He made 12-year-old me believe a man could run faster than lightning. That's what it would look like. Yeah, absolutely, man.
That's a good point. I like that. I like that story. That's nice. Yeah. Yeah, so. He really captured motion really well. Like, without it looking, without cheating, you know, like it was just, I don't know, it you know, because it's like, oh, I'll draw a face and some blurs and, you know, now it's fast. Like, no, he really captured motion really well, which is very hard to do and keep it consistent without like making it exaggerated or inconsistent within your own art style. Like, it felt like seamless between, you know, people talking, superheroes getting, you know, putting on their outfits or you know, swinging, running, doesn't matter. All the action worked. Slinging a bow didn't matter. It was all and he made it look effortless. That's the other thing, is that his art looks, it's so distinct and it's got such a style, and yet it has this effortless quality to it. You're like, right, that's what these characters look like, and that's how it would come about, right?
Deceptively simple looking.
Yes. Yeah.
But a lot of emotion and a lot of fun and adventure in every brush strokes. I know, and pencil stroke. I know what you mean. You know, I'm going to ask you guys if you have a favorite specific Ringo story. And if you want, I'll start, because I have a feeling maybe you guys will agree. But we talked about Wade and Ringo doing a Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
But man, and it was so great. Doom finally kills Ben Grimm.
Yes.
And Ben is dead, and everyone's really bummed. And Reed seems to be buried in his work. And it's like, Reed, you haven't said anything. Ben's dead. And it's like, oh, I know. We're going after him. We're going to get him back. And it's like, and the Fantastic Four goes to heaven and meets the creator. And the creator is somebody slumped over his drafting board. And I think we all know who I'm talking about. And it's the great Jack Kirby.
Yeah.
And it's just. Yeah. Really, it was just kind of perfect that, of course, Jack created the Marvel Universe. Of course he's God. Why wouldn't he be?
Right.
And, yeah. And it just, and it really, and again, this beautiful cartoony, simple style, but just so much emotion in that. And it really, it just, it was one of those beautiful stories that Mark and Mike were able to give us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I guess I'll just throw out mine. I loved, there was a, during the Spider-Man Other story, they did this like big, they did this Spider-Man costume variant where it was just like the same costume. Well, it was the, every Spider-Man, same pose, different costume. And there's like, I don't know, 400 of them or something, but it's just, it's this iconic image of Spider-Man doing his thing. And all these like explosions and, you know, character, you know, villainous accoutrement in the background. But like there's, but every single different costume he's ever had. And it's just, that's, it's something you see everywhere. Like you see anytime a costume comes up, that's the image they use. And it's like, you see it everywhere. And it's like, you would never know, like, you know, because it's just, you'd be ubiquitous with the character and it's his work. And it's just like, yeah, it's everywhere. It's still there, you know, like, he hasn't drawn a page in, you know,
11 years,
and he's, and yet you see it every day, or yeah, at least you should if you, you know, if you're looking, yeah, for it.
That's this, oh, this is a hard question. I'd have to say Telos.
Oh.
Everything he did with that, and I didn't read it when it first came out, but I read it later. And Todd DeZago, kind of his continuation of pushing that, I think, is wonderful. I would say everything about that. And I love that it was in the yearbook at Baltimore one year. They did, yeah, that as a tribute.
Yep.
I've loved all of them. I loved the Black Sad last year, but that, yeah, that one was my favorite. I love it because he loved animals. He was a vegan, and
oh, yeah,
which I strive to be, but I can't. he's a much better person than I am. But I think it just showed him the most in that story.
Mm.
Understood.
Yeah. So creator-owned work tends to, you know, you really put your personality or your everything. Well, it's all right out there, right? Because, you know, anyone can kind of like almost hide behind a larger than life character. Mm-hmm. But when you're creating characters, when you're putting them out there, when you're like, this is me, this is everything I think is important because everything else is owned by other people. Like here's everything that I have. It's not only, you know, incredibly scary, but it's also so vulnerable. And it's just like, here's everything that I have to say. And I always loved the visual style of Telos. Mm-hmm. I remember, oh, yeah, just being introduced to it because I knew ancillary people connected with Mike, where I was like, you know, I'd see it everywhere. And I'm like, oh, that's such a, like, I just, it's everything you like about his work with his personality infused directly into it, where you're just like, it's so charming. It's just genuinely charming.
I've got another tribute. We want to make sure, as we're less than an hour away, just over 40 minutes,
oh, wow,
before the Ringos begin. And another former studio mate of Mike's. Here's Richard Case, everybody.
Hello, my name is Richard Case, and I wanted to welcome you all to this year's Ringo Awards. Cheers. So I was asked to tell a little story about Mike, as we were old friends and studio mates for a good long time, and I also collaborated with him on Sensational Spider-Man, along with Todd DeZego, who wrote it, and I was inking Mike on that book. And this story takes place, it was a little after our time on Spidey, and Mike and Todd had already started creating Telos at that point. And so this took place probably right around the time that they were starting to promote that book. And, you know, being that this was their, you know, their creation, and everything, they were, you know, a little nervous about it and very excited about it. So we were all flying from different directions to this convention in Chicago, and I know Todd got there first, flying in from New York, and Mike and I were flying up from North Carolina to come to the show. And we got about halfway there, and then suddenly we were like landing in Indianapolis. Turns out there was snow in the forecast, and there was ice on the wings or something like that. So we spent a good chunk of an afternoon sitting on a on the plane, on the tarmac, not going anywhere. And we got to a point where, you know, we were just getting really frustrated. To help pass the time, I was kind of just sketching in my sketchbook, but I eventually got tired of doing that and probably passed out or something like that. But Mike asked me, you know, hey, can I bum your sketchbook for a bit? And I know he was, you know, he was getting a little, you know, anxious and irate, actually, a little bit even. Just the fact that, you know, he knows Todd's there and he's like, you know, he's worried about him and getting, you know, he's all by himself. And, you know, that's how Mike was. He, you know, looked out for his friends and stuff like that. So, so anyway, when he borrows my sketchbook and he starts sketching, and what he sketches is this image, and it's a shot of Todd as he imagined him, you know, just sitting there all by himself, just sulking, and, you know, his little pet animals all missing him greatly. And here we were supposed, you know, with the promise that we were going to be there to keep him company, and he wasn't, you know, yet he was all by himself, kind of thing. And I just thought it was kind of funny, and it kind of greatly shows how Mike was always, you know, concerned about everybody else and how, you know, how his friends were doing, kind of thing. So, and I know it meant a lot to Todd too, because you know, after Mike passed, it was one of the things that, you know, he always remembered that sketch, and so he asked me for that. You know, he still have that sketch, and of course I still have it. So, so I sent him that. So this is a copy of it. So the original now is in Todd's hands, framed on a wall somewhere. So anyway, that was my little anecdote of, you know, just what a, you know, a good friend that Mike was, and how he was always looking out for the other guy. So, all right. Well, y'all enjoy. Thanks.
Richard Case.
These are great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they really are. Honestly, it was great receiving them. I taped a lot of them. That's why occasionally you might see the word balloon logo. That was not an intended advertisement. Sorry, everybody. But no, it's, man, I'll tell you, I'm saving a couple of the real ones that will make us cry for the end here. Oh, but yeah. Sorry.
The older I get, the more I cry. People, so.
No, I understand, man. Again, yeah, it's August is always really melancholy, because that's when we lost Mike. That's when we also lost Mike Turner. Mm-hmm. And in both cases, it was right after conventions. And it was really just such a shock. We were all just, you know, that great afterglow after a con. I always say traveling to conventions, and I'm sure you guys feel the same way, especially for out-of-state shows, it's like expensive summer camp.
Yes.
Because you're going, and it's all our out-of-town friends, and we're hanging out, and we're having dinner, and after-hour drinks, and just hanging. And it's this great feeling. And you're wiped out, but it's like, all right, yeah, man, it was good. We were all hanging out. And literally, in both cases, well, Mike Turner, sadly, it was during a Wizard World Chicago. We found out on Friday, and really half the guests left on Saturday to go back to L.A. And pay tribute and do what they can for the Turner family. I remember Jeff Johns and Jeff Loeb and among others that just, yeah, it was just horrible. And Mike, it was, yeah, that Monday after the con, and it's like, we just saw him. And I mean, really, I mean, he was at Chicago, and we all were just talking to him and stuff. And then, you know, now he's still with us, but, you know, now he's just inside of us, and it's tough. It's a shame. And I, you know, I for years I was in sports talk radio, and I had to produce a lot of memorials to people that went, athletes and stuff. And sometimes I felt insincere, because this was part of my job, and I did the best I could. And I don't think I slouched or disrespected anybody, but it just didn't feel personal.
Yeah.
And I have to say, this year doing these Ringo tributes, it was an honor to do them. And yeah, because Mike really does. He still means a lot to me. So I feel that I'm paying him back for all the great stuff he did for me.
Yeah.
You know?
I think Mark Nathan has said it best when he has said he has a lot of good stories to tell about Mike, but he doesn't have enough stories to tell because time took him away from everybody way too soon.
Yeah.
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 So.
Yeesh. I know, guys. Believe me, it's tough. I know I'm going to make Christy cry again. I'm sorry.
I'm going to, can I give a shout out to some Baltimore people?
Please, absolutely.
The Baltimore Comic-Con, like I said, it's family. And I really want to give a shout out to Brad and to Roger and to Andy and to Constance. I was so looking forward to meeting the baby. And who else? Randy and, of course, Shelly, who works so, so hard, and Lauren and Mark. And I feel so honored that they, you know, took me in to their family, and Tom Zoller and Steve Conley.
Steve Conley too. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Steve, his, I want to talk about, he's amazing.
Yeah.
Even though he doesn't understand how awesome ELO is.
Oh, well, there he's wrong. There he is wrong.
No, he just torments me about it.
I love ELO. Absolutely.
But, they're my favorite band in the world. But I mean, Brad puts together all with the guests, and Roger with the panels, and Constant keeps everything and registration and all of us sane, and well, as sane as we can be, and Dustin, and it's just like there's so many people there, and Lynn, and there's so many people that just work so hard, and it means so much to everybody, and I just wanted to shout out to them and tell them how much I know that Mark and Shelley love them and appreciate everything that they do, how much I love them. And just, we miss everybody, but you know, we're all here. So I just wanted to make sure they all knew that.
No, that was great. Absolutely. That's it. You know, I've got some of the nominees up here, and I want to talk about some of them, and I am going to bring up, these again, we're just over a half hour now from the Ringo Awards.
Wow. Yeah.
Kevin Smith will start things off for us. We've got a great Jeff Johns keynote speech.
I'm so looking forward to that.
Yeah. So it's going to be great. But honestly, yeah, I wanted to get some of our opinions on some of the nominees and take a look at the horse race and get our opinions. But pardon me, I'm drinking my seltzer. And it's coming back to haunt me. So I want to start off with the best graphic novel. Let's see what we got there, man.
Sure.
So, and man, you know, thank God I got my glasses on right now. Look at all those nominees. I'm looking at.
There's so many good ones. Snow Glass Apples is. I loved it. I just loved it.
Yeah.
I got a couple copies for the store, and they sold. And I was like, but I don't want to sell this one. Give me it back. You can't have it. But
Penny Nichols from Top Shelf is great.
Yeah. And I'm even Dogman, who
yeah.
I probably would have never read it, except it was obviously nominated because it's nominated all the time. Now, I have to admit, I do read all Raina's books, not because I have to, just because I still love them. But Dogman is surprisingly entertaining. I was like, really? But, you know, I was like, okay, but it's actually good. But, you know, that's a really hard, a hard group to choose from. So
totally.
I want to assure CK Johnson, this is only six people are watching. No, we're on several panels or on several platforms right now.
Yeah.
CK, we got a few hundred people watching currently. don't worry about it, but it's okay. I just wanted to reassure him that, oh man, nobody's
watching. Don't worry.
No. People are watching and people are thinking about Mike and thinking about these categories and these awards. So yeah. Let's see. I'm going to bring back up the group here. Let's see. Best comic strip. Let's check that out for a second. So, man, I'll tell you, Nancy, I got to acknowledge Nancy, and this is my own personal feeling. Honestly, Olivia has done such an amazing job modernizing Nancy, but still maintaining the classic look. But I love the fact that Nancy is absolutely a 21st century Nancy now, and it's great. Yeah.
I'm completely biased here, though. I'd go with middle-aged Steve Conley.
Sure.
Completely cool. Biased, but I love that. I absolutely love that. Every time, it's so good.
That's awesome. So
that would be mine.
I understand. And truly, thank God there are still comic strips because,
yeah,
you know, mm-hmm. really with the where the state of newspapers and, you know, I'm a Comics Kingdom subscriber, the King Features subscription thing. It's a great deal. Here's an unbiased commercial for Comics Kingdom.
Really, they'll appreciate
it. It's like $20 a year and you get and you can curate your own funny pages.
Wow.
And the great thing is not only does it have all the current stuff and a great archive, but you can also throw in a lot of classic stuff. And I've been reading Dan Barry Flash Gordon and John Cullen Murphy's Big Ben Bolt. I'm a boxing fan. And it was The Adventures of a Heavyweight Contender. And just one of those great adventure strips. So yeah, I mean, you know, Secret Agent Corrigan, you can throw in there Spider-Man, so many great things. And it's, yeah, it's honestly, so I love comic strips, and I'm always glad that they're still an important part of the mix of comics. So
yeah.
Let's see, what else have we got? We could do, let's see. Oh, we got Best Humor, of course.
Ooh.
And this is
really tough, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Like, so subjective.
Superman's pal, Jimmy Olsen, is completely underrated.
Yeah,
I don't think it's underrated. Do you think it's underrated?
In most people, well, under the radar, I guess it would.
Well, be. I mean, fair. Maybe you're speaking from
under the radar.
Your own store's perspective.
I was like, no, you have to get this book. And people were like, it's Jimmy. I'm like, you have to get this book. It's so good. But I also like Twisted.
Yes, sure.
I think Source Point Press is one of the best presses out there right now.
Yeah.
But I also. I really like Rick and Morty versus Dungeons & Dragons.
That's excellent.
It's so good.
It's so funny.
That was one of my choices last year also.
and to Dungeons & Dragons fans, we should point out that there's going to be some gaming tonight after the Ringo's going on.
Yep,
and
11 o'clock.
Yeah, Sal, help me out. Jim Zub, Cecil Castellucci. Right?
Yes. Oh, my God.
Jim Zub is the Dungeons & Dragons king.
Yeah. I know he runs his own game. We one of the ways we got him was just by saying, like, listen, you just get to play. Like, don't worry, you just have to play. And he's like, I'm in. Like, I'm in. Please. Yeah. Let me see if I can pull up the whole crew.
While you're doing that, I'm gonna acknowledge Sam Humphreys.
Please do, yeah.
It was Mark Russell, pardon me, with the Wonder Twins. Mark is one of the best humor writers out there. Mm-hmm. And man, I did not. I mean, he did an amazing job with the Wonder Twins. It's a book that we've all been begging for decades, literally. And I'm so glad that finally it happened.
Yeah,
and it really was. It was a tremendous run. I'm sorry that it's ended. But
that's a tough category.
Yeah. And kidding, man. Yeah. Honestly, and no disrespect to Fangs or Lazy.
Oh yeah, not well. Into that, but yeah.
No, that and that's why I brought it up. I really think that's one of the more interesting categories. Mm-hmm. That I think it's quite a horse race, and really a
it
lot
is.
Of, and maybe, I thank God that humor is back and done well in comics, because again, that's another genre. We did a horror panel today and had to, because I mean it's so great to see at a great comic shop how there's a wall of great horror comics.
Oh yeah,
it's not just a shelf or two, and that's amazing in itself. And thank God it seems like. Now humor is starting to come back.
Well, we really need it.
I want to, and actually they're not nominated this year, but I want to give a shout out to Ahoy Comics and all their great books, because my God, so many of my favorite people, and I know old friends of yours and mine, Christy, people like Tom Pyre and Stuart Moore and Jamal Igle and the like that are
Jamal,
and Mark Russell. And that's one of the reasons why seeing him nominated for Wonder Twins, all the stuff that's happening at Ahoy right now, I have a feeling that they will be populating the Ringo's next year.
The Edgar Allan Poe Snifter of Terror is great. It's just great.
No, I agree.
I'm biased there too, because my dog's named Poe, you know, but it's such a good book.
It's a great parody of those fantastic Gold Key and Western, like, you know, when they were doing Twilight Zone and Thriller and all those great books. So no, I get it, man. That's awesome. All right, I'm checking the time. I should get back to some more tributes.
Yes, yeah.
Because we still have some left.
I'm dying to see the Scotty Young one.
Well, ask
about that.
Ye shall receive. 1 second. Let me bring up the Scotty.
He was great that first year. He had us all crying and laughing at the same time.
Yeah. Well, he's doing it again. Here's Scotty Young, everybody.
Mike was a dear friend and a mentor to me in the beginning of my career. I was a young kid coming up in this business, trying to figure out how to draw, how to navigate, how to stand my ground. And Mike was always there for me to give his experiences. And over the years of our friendship, we spent many, many hours on the phone while we're drawing, laughing, talking about movies, talking about comics, seeing who found the new Olivier Vatine hardcover art book from France. He meant a lot to me. I probably would not be where I am today if we wouldn't have had our friendship when we did. I love you, Mike. I miss you, man. I think you'd be excited to see what all of us cartoony talking animal artists have been able to accomplish because of your inspiration. Love you, buddy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I hear you. You know, I mean, and it's so, I mean, if there's one student to Mike's mentorship that I would point to, it for me, it's Scotty. It really is, because I really think Scotty really did connect with Mike on a real spiritual level. And also, it's been a pleasure watching Scotty evolve from when he started to where he is now. Not just as a creator, but also a guy that understands that you have to be a businessman as well. And seriously, like Sal, you'll appreciate this from a crowdfunding standpoint.
Sure, yeah.
Like Scotty and I would like, really, when Patreon first came on the scene, you know, he's like, what do you think? And I'm like, well, you know, I like it. What do you think? And it's like, he's like, I'm looking at him, man. I'm looking at him really carefully. And yeah, it was just, Mike did it in a quiet way. And Scotty was never disrespectful, but like if a book came up and Scotty didn't want to do it and it was still a big book, he'd say no.
Right.
And I think that really shocked, especially Marvel at times.
Oh, totally.
Because yeah, I mean, Scotty really did what he wanted to do. And I mean, you know, those great Wizard of Oz books that Scotty did with, with Eric.
Eric Schanauer.
You know, they were great for the book market. But it took him out of the comic shops for a while. I mean,
yeah.
Good shops were carrying the comics and the trades, but really it was more of a bookstore product. And it really took him away for a couple of years in the middle of his prime, but he really wanted to do that as opposed to, you know, doing, you know, name the hero, name it a solo Avenger or X-Men or whatever.
Seriously, yeah.
And I love that about Scotty. I really do. And now, God, with all of his creator-owned stuff, it's just outstanding. And I know that it wouldn't have only been Talos that Mike would be doing right now, creator. Mm-hmm. And I know Scotty probably misses those likely conversations they'd be having right now.
Yeah.
So, yeah. You know.
I tell you what, I do a live sales show 4 times a week. And anytime there's a Scotty book, everybody wants it. You know,
yeah.
And I have quite a few because I'm a huge fan. So if I'd like something, we have a lot of it. So.
I had him. I'm sorry. I had him recreate for a sketch for me once, and it's on one of my walls that you can't see right now. But he did a YA version of Iron Man and the Armor Wars, and there was a great classic cover that he did of Tony holding the helmet in almost that great Hamlet, Alas, Poor Yorick. I knew him well.
Yeah.
Pose, and it really it's one of my favorite pieces I have. And it's in that scratchy Scotty style to do
the way
he did it and everything. And it really is. And it's great. And it's, you know, it's not that big. It's only so big. But I just do it. And it's great. My nephews will come and they look at the art. They love the fact, you know, Uncle John's house is a play. I am Uncle Buck. I don't do I really am. You know, I don't smoke the cigars, but pretty
so
much.
You're making pancakes.
I am, absolutely. with the snow shovel, 100%. And they come, and that's like one of the ones that they're always like, wow, that's really cool. And they don't even know the Shakespearean reference, but
sure.
Just seeing Iron Man holding his helmet and everything and looking at it.
That's
and it's
awesome.
Like, you know, yeah, so that's Scotty, you know?
That's Scotty. He's the, yep. He's just, Scotty's awesome.
He's the best. He's the best. He we can talk about another couple of categories before we go back to our last couple of tributes. There's only two left of the tributes. Okay. Like I said, I'm saving, and Scotty's an emotional one. And like I said, I'm saving the best stuff for last. And I'm blabbing right now to get to the ring. I'm totally stealing.
Oh, please.
All right. So we got, best cover artist. This is cool.
Oh, yeah, cool. Oh man.
And another
good choice.
Yeah, man. Absolutely. This is great. I'm a big Christian Ward fan. Absolutely.
I got to get the amazing. My pick's monstrous. Monstrous
I,
is
I have
so
to,
good.
Yeah, I have to pick Sana. I tell you what, though, what I love about this is just the scope. You know, it's just everything on this. Anybody on this list could win, and I wouldn't be disappointed. But I tell you what, Monstrous blows me away.
Yes.
Every issue, the art and the writing blows me away. It is still one of our best-selling books. And I will suggest it to people, and they're like, I don't know. And I'm like, just read, here's the dollar issue. It's actually, I think, $1.50 because it's a double issue.
Ah.
Here you go. Just take this. And then they come back and can I have all of them?
Get the rest. Yeah. Then you got it. And that's always so wonderful when you sell an indie series or a smaller press series where you sell the first volume and then you sell the rest of the run. And you're like, I got to order the whole run again.
Exactly. Exactly.
Hey, David Peterson is.
Hey,
David.
How are you, David? Glad this year I don't have to learn how poorly my dress clothes fit.
Tell
David,
Julia,
we missed you, man. Yes.
Hi, Julia.
Absolutely. Hey, Julia. My God. I miss
Julia
you.
Gave me some of the best advice in the world about having a grandbaby. So I am indebted to her forever. So she and David are two of the nicest people in the world also.
That's hilarious. No, that's fantastic. The great legend is here. Thank you very much, Johnny Ringo. Indeed. Indeed. Thank you, my man. That's hilarious. All right. While there's time, because there's now just about 19 minutes before
start.
And like I said, we've got two more tributes that I want to get to, and I have to keep switching screens to get to the video. Okay. So where's my guy? There he is. Another guy that goes way back with Mike, and that's Jeff Parker, the great writer.
Oh, Jeff.
Hi. So we're remembering Mike Waringo. Boy, if you want the really good stuff, when we start having conventions in person again, just come up to me because I'm not recording any of that. But, you know, there's nothing bad anyone's ever going to tell you. I mean, at the risk of making Mike a saint, he was just an incredibly fun person to know. Everybody's probably already talked about his booming laugh, which, you know, just encourages you to try to make him laugh. One of my favorite things I was thinking about was at convention season is how Mike and I would often we'd either drive together or we'd fly together, sitting on the airplane. And as soon as we'd hit the show floor, though, it was like we'd both look and agree later, not get lost and bolt. And I had more than a few people come up to me and say, "Hey, what's going on with you guys? Are you doing okay? Because, you know, like you guys don't eat together, you don't talk, you don't do anything during the show. Aren't you in a studio?" And we were in Artemis Studio in Hillsborough, North Carolina, for years in the 90s. And then I'd have to explain. It's like, yes, and that's why we try as hard as we can to stay apart during the show. Because when we're working together, you know, we've heard all our stories at that point. You know, we're telling anything, like, you know, Cully Hamner calls Mike from Gaijin, and then we get to hear later, like, anything Cully said. You know, and it's like we're just living for any details because there was no big giant internet forum or Twitter or anything where you could keep up with what was going on in the comics industry. It was all about your network of friends and whatever they chose to tell you, how believable that might be. So Mike and I would, you know, we'd hang out with everybody we could, go to dinners and all that, and just like, I think both of us were visually, you know, just like locking it all in. And then when we get back to the studio, then, you know, we'd spend the next few weeks just trying to remember everything that we heard and saw to tell each other. And it was just kind of a fun little coping mechanism to give us material to discuss at the studios that was often misinterpreted by everyone around us. If I get time for one more, one of my favorite memories, though, is New Year's Eve, and I think it was like 97 or 98, and Mike and I both found ourselves not in relationships at the end of the year, and thus we had no parties or whatever to go to, and one of us called, and we're just chatting, and like, what are you doing? And they're like, I don't know, let's go down Hillsborough Street or something, and, you know, and maybe get a beer. And that night on New Year's Eve, we just went to a bar, just the two of us, and we played trivia. And, you know, you put a lot of pressure on, at the time, you know, when you're younger, you put a lot of pressure on having fun on New Year's Eve and making something big happen. But precisely because we went the other route and it's just us hanging out, having a great time, trying to beat some other people in a bar at trivia. Do they still do that, by the way? It's just one of my absolute favorite memories of hanging out with him. And we were pretty good, by the way. We knew a lot of useless facts combined. I don't know what to say. I love the guy, and I wish all of you could have gotten to know him as well as I did. I did not realize how lucky I was at the time. Have a great Ringo Awards and enjoy the virtual con.
There you go. Yeah, you know, I mean, that's this is why I love Parker, man. He's one of my favorite people, and he's just that kind of great laconic kind of just shaggy dog kind of, you know, we just had a good time. He's
It's my man from Uncle Buddy.
That's awesome. That's fantastic. And of course, big James Bond writer. And yep. So we had a spy comic panel with Parker and Rob Meyer Burnett talking about spy comics. So no, I honestly, I love Jeff. Jeff, one of the best Batman 66 writers.
Yeah.
When that DC book was happening and stuff. And that's the thing. There's another great writer that can combine humor with action.
Oh,
and
stuff.
Yeah.
And just do great comics.
Original art, I have two of the pages from Batman 66 Meets the Man from U.N.C.L.E.
Ooh.
Oh, that's fantastic. Sure. Yeah. All those crossovers were great. The Green
Hornet. Oh, yeah, they were great.
Yes.
With our own Ringo host, Kevin Smith. That's coming up in about 15 minutes, everybody. So that's it's coming fast and furious.
That's right.
So let's see. You know, all right, I am going to play it. Okay. I saved the best Ringo tribute for last. I mean, again, Todd DeZago, so many other great Dan Slott, so many great Ringo collaborators over the years. I think Mark Waid is a guy that we all kind of think of when we think of Mike. And and Mark had a really nice tribute, and here it is now.
I have worked over the past 35 years with hundreds of artists and collaborators. And to this day, there's been no one better than Michael Ringo. I miss him every day. I think that some of the best work that I've ever done, I've been able to do because he was my partner. I first knew of him back before the Flash days. I had seen none of his work, actually. I was standing in editor Brian Augustin's office, and we were looking for a new artist. And I looked down on Brian's desk, and upside down on the desk, upside down to me, was a page from an issue of Justice League Quarterly, a 10-pager that he had drawn, just come in. And I knew, looking at that page upside down, out of context, I took one look at it and said, that's our guy. And we got a upside, you know, right side up look at it, and it looked even better. But I got to tell you, that was our guy. And Brian loved Mike's art, got a hold of him immediately. And That's what gave me my second wind on the Flash after the return of Barry Allen. He did things with the way you visualize speed, with the way that you visualize that character that people are still using as reference points, artists are still using as reference points. And it, working with him was just a delight. And then we moved over to Fantastic Four and did that for nearly 3 years. And I got to tell you that, again, one of the best working experiences I've ever had in my life. Mike was always up for the challenge. He enjoyed talking about the stories ahead of time, but he didn't feel, he was always hesitant about putting, you know, infringing, quote unquote, too much in my lane, you know, but which is baloney. I mean, Mike was a good storyteller. So I always encouraged him. Let's talk this thing out. As a matter of fact, about halfway through the FF run, maybe a little after halfway through, I just said, look, can we just do plot dialogue now? Can we just do where I just send you the plot and then you work out the pacing and the pages and I'll put in the dialogue later? Is that okay with you? And he was nervous about it, but he was fine with it. And I think it's some of our best work. My favorite memory of Mike on a professional level is that I went to his office once way early on. I think we'd done like 2 issues of Flash and I was driving through his neck of the woods, stopped into his studio and met him for the first time. Swell guy, and saw how he was working. And it was insane. No wonder he was making himself sick working around the clock. He would do real rough thumbnails of every page. And then he would do very, very tight breakdowns of every page. And then he would do very, very, very tight drawings of each page that, you know, not even drawn, not even on the page yet, just on typing paper. And then he would light box it onto a piece of artboard and draw it for the fourth time. And it always looked great. It never lost anything in the translation. But boy, he was just, you know, that's no way to work, dude. You'll kill yourself. You know, he got the confidence not too long after that to really just put the pencil to the paper and let magic happen. He was kind. He was funny. He was always there to talk. He, and I've never forgotten this, and I will never forget this. We were on Fantastic Four. The then publisher of the company didn't like what we were doing and asked that I be fired off the book. And without hesitation, Mike said, all right, I'm going to. I didn't have another gig lined up. I had other stuff I could do, but he didn't have other stuff he had lined up. But nonetheless, Mike just said, you know what? Mark's gone, I'm gone. And I will never forget during our time together, and will never forget that's the kind of integrity that man had. He was, again, great to work with. His sense of style was strong. I love the fact that I would call him often. This is the thing. When I, as a comic book writer, you want to be kind to your artists. You don't want to continue to make them draw things, ask them to draw things that are insane, that would take them forever and they will hate you. So I remember, you know, if I'm going to do like a baseball stadium in a comic book, I'm going to call the artist ahead of time and say, are you good with this? This is a lot of work. And they always are, but they appreciate the heads up. But Mike, I would call him up and I'd say, listen, this scene is in an auto body shop, which means it's pretty complex. Are you okay with that? And he would just laugh and say, yeah, because I've never drawn that before. That was his answer every time to any time I posed something to him that I thought might be formidable to draw. He dove into it with enthusiasm. An infinite library full of infinite bookcases. Great. I've never drawn that before. That'll be fun. That was Mike all over. It's been years, and I don't know. It's August 12th will always suck as the day that Mike passed away. And I am lifting a virtual glass to you, sir. You deserve all the accolades that you're getting now. I only wish that you were around to hear them. And I wish that when you were alive, you would have believed that people had cared this much about your work, because they do.
Yeah. I know.
Okay.
I know we're all verklempt. I understand.
thanks, John.
Right? Come on, man.
This is what I've been doing.
His best work was with Mike. So it just is, well, it just.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and like Mark said, that unified front, and I'll say the name, when Bill Jemis decided that, okay, that's enough of these guys, let's bring in a new team. And the entire fandom is just like, are you nuts?
Yeah.
And truly, you know, fine, Mark was pissed and everything, but Mike was ready. Hey, man, you're taking him off, you're taking me off. Well, what do you mean? That means the look of the book might have to change. Right. And it just shows that importance of the hand-in-hand relationship of the best creative teams where they have each other's back. And it's like, no, it is a partnership. The writing is as important as the art. And I know a lot of times the scale in the 90s, it was art and then writer. 2000s, it was writer then art. I do believe that we're in a period right now where it may not be completely equal, but the scale's bouncing towards equal. And I really think the knowledgeable fan recognizes that it is the writer doesn't do all the storytelling, that really 80% of what you're reading is coming from the artist as far as visually. It's visual media.
Yeah.
Well,
but as Neil Gaiman would always say, sorry, Christy, real fast, it's the combination that makes comics special. And it's bigger and more creative than a lot of times laymen give it credit. Please, Christy. Mm-hmm.
No, I was just going to say, just today I learned, again, from Absolute Carnage, when they're walking in to meet Peter Parker, and there's 616 on the apartment door. And I said, this is great. Who thought of that? It was all Ryan. So, what makes comics special is that combination. Not saying that, you know, cartoonists like Terry Moore, his stuff is brilliant, but there's just something about that. Yeah, so I do need to mention a few more people.
Well, all right, because honestly, we are at crunch time.
So. For, David Jeffries, who puts everything together, thank you to him. All of the volunteers, Chris McClelland, Alex, Sam, Mandy Santiago, Tracy Schmid, all of these people helped to make Baltimore what it is, and I totally forgot to mention them. I'm so sorry, you guys.
Well, and you that's awesome.
And so thank you to everybody. And Mark and Shelley, of course, you have my heart always.
Yeah.
And Mandy's whole family comes help her kids. It's just everybody is so great. So
I just
want to make sure I mentioned that before we ran out of time.
Well, I understand and I appreciate that. And thank you, Mark Nathan. Thank you, Randy Tischler, for what you do for Baltimore as well. And thank you, Sal and Christy for helping me out on this red carpet.
Oh, thank you both.
It's my honor.
We're just a couple minutes away, everybody. Stick around. It's going to be the Ringo Awards. Kevin Smith opening the show. An incredible keynote speech as well coming up from Jeff Johns, and it's going to be a great awards night. I hope everybody enjoys it, and I hope you'll continue to enjoy. We got one more day of Baltimore Comic Con. I mean, a lot, and then also after the Ringos, we got a Lucifer panel. Me and Joe Henderson talking to Lucy fans, and a great D&D session for you gamers out there tonight, and a whole slate starting early 10 o'clock in the morning all the way till midnight Eastern time. How about that? 14 hours of Comic-Con for you. Thanks a lot for watching.
You're doing a great job, John. Thank you.
Everyone's doing a great job. Seriously, enjoy the Ringos, and we'll all be back soon. Thank you very much.
Good luck.